been mentioning this morning, there was a boy out in Jackson County, I think his name was Carter. He jumped into a pool, and when he did, he broke his neck, and he set up in the hospital. Young boy, I think he's in his teen, I think he's a teenager, and he's paralyzed, and I think best he can do is move his hands, move his fingers, and I think he has surgery tomorrow to stabilize some more. So if we remember him, and Ernie and Louise, they had to leave out. Louise's son is having trouble breathing, and they're taking him to the hospital. So lift him up, and I know we have several special requests as well. So Brother Ed, if you would say your blessing over the CD's offering. Ronnie Kaiser, thank you. Yeah, Ronnie Armstrong, well, Ronnie Kaiser didn't do well at all. So we really know him. Go ahead, brother.
Father,
I pray
the same
thing
to you, the opportunity to sing in your house of worship. In the blessings, I want to make a way out. Father, we pray for this offering that is due to your kingdoms that are on earth, that your heart is good.
He's always on that. We're going to do one now that kind of, it's one that I've been, this is one of the ones I wrote a long time ago. But I wrote this song based on some personal experiences. As Christians, it seems like we have a problem sharing Jesus sometimes. And we live in a society that promotes a ideology that we're going to somehow offend someone by sharing Jesus. Well, I would rather offend someone than face Jesus himself and know that because I was disobedient, that person didn't make heaven. Amen? We have to be obedient. And I see so much. Those are nice, comfortable seats. They're not exactly bathroom friendly. I'm just saying, those seats were made when Charleston was poor. Just saying, that was like pre-cheeseburger right there, okay? It's like, BBS really hadn't took off yet, you know what I'm saying? But padded church pews are great. There's only one problem with padded church pews. Sometimes we get a little bit too comfortable. Went to church one time when I was a little girl. Actually, went there several times. It was the first church I ever started out in with my grandparents. And had these really awesome, uncomfortable church benches. I'm talking like no padding. The only padding was on them seats was one's good little kid, okay? And I noticed that back then, when the pastor would stand up and he'd say, "Does anybody have a testimony?" Dude, they was like popcorn. They was coming up off the pews all over the church. Well, as a kid, I couldn't figure that out. As an adult, I get it. That things are uncomfortable. I'll stand up and tell you about anything to get off that seat. But then along came the church pews. And we, the church, we get comfortable. And we get cozy. And, you know, yeah, God really, he did something great for me today, but boy, this seat's comfortable. My back's hurting. Boy, this seat feels good. I don't think I'll stand up. Anybody cares about that old testimony of mine anyway. Your itty-bitty testimony can change a life. Your itty-bitty testimony could save a soul. It's that important, church, that we be obedient. That we do one simple thing. One thing that Christ has asked of us. Tell the world about Jesus.
Yes.
And stand and testify. Amen? Anything else?
Done. Amen. She's taking care of her.
back to this. Outlaw preacher. I don't have a big, huge testimony to, you know, God delivered me from this, or God delivered me from that. I'm pretty much basically two-shoes. I was just telling the sister and brother out there holding up, I said, you know, you got these people to talk about God delivering them from drugs. God delivered them from alcohol. God delivered them from an outlaw lifestyle. You know, God delivered me from cold. I never did any of that. And you know why? Because I met Jesus at a young age. And he was all I ever needed. I didn't need the drugs. I didn't need the alcohol. I didn't go searching for the things that would make me happy because I had Jesus in my heart. I had no desire for any of that. I still to this day, I can't even comprehend it. I can't understand, brother, how you could pick a needle over the Redeemer. I can't grasp it. My mind is not big enough, I guess. I'm not worldly enough. But praise God for that. I had a good day.
Amen.
Don't you dare start crying. He raised me in church. I raised my kids in church. You see where he's at, don't you? Funny looking pants, but you see where he's at. Now that is one of my all-time favorite songs. I love to hear him sing it. It's an old Gaither song. And some of those old songs, you know, church, don't chalk off the old songs. Because I'm going to tell you what, God's power and anointing doesn't change. It doesn't change. If that song was anointed 100 years ago, that song is always and forever anointed. It's just that we get lost sometimes and we don't even listen to the words of these songs anymore. Listen real close. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary.
Thank you.
ain't over, brother. Revival, it ain't over.
Right.
You know, everybody says, revival's coming. Revival's coming. Revival's coming. I'm going, here we go. I am ready for revival.
Yeah.
And then I'm ready. I'd like to see it break loose on the west side of Charleston. The west side of Charleston ain't lost.
Right.
They're not. We're here. It's up to us to go out there and minister and reach people. They are not a lost cause, folks.
Right.
You know, you have people that sit back and they say, well, I go out there and I witness, but I tell you what, I can't get in trouble. I'm afraid to. I'm afraid I'll get myself hurt. Oh, yield your faith. Who goes before you is greater than any adversary that you're going to face out there on the streets. You know, we're getting ready, baby, to do this thing in September called the Ride for Jesus. And I'm excited. We were out there, we were talking about that earlier. And the Ride for Jesus started out simply on a random teenager's thought. We were talking about how all these clubs have these poker rooms. You know, and they go from club to club, they go from bar to bar. And they, you know, just do poker cards, and at the end of the ride, whoever's got the best hand, you know, they get part of the money or whatever they get. I've only went on one of them. Really didn't interest me, so I didn't really went on any more. But we were at the lake. Brandon said, you know, it's a shame that you got these poker rounds where you go from bar to bar. He said, man, wouldn't it be cool if we could, like, do one and you go church to church? I said, huh. From the mouth of babes. That's a big baby. From the mouth of babes. And I said, well, why couldn't we? What? What? What?
I said, with funny looking pants.
With funny looking pants, of course. Yeah,
judge.
But I said, you know, I believe we can do that. So we started the Ride for Jesus, and it went really good the first year. We went to, I think, four different churches, and it was a bit lengthy. So the second year, we decided to shorten it down and change it up a little bit. Well, God began to mold this. You know, when you give God full reign and full control, you'd be surprised what God can create. But what we do, we have a tendency to try to tell God what we feel would work best, and then we get in God's way. Well, we gave this to God, and once we created it, let's say, through God's divine thought, we kind of backed out of the way and said, you know what, this needs to be a joint effort. We need to get other churches and other ministries involved in this and let this grow. So last year, we started it as a tent revival, 3-day tent revival, and then arrived the next day. And it's just continuing to grow every year. So this year, we were down here at the church one afternoon, and we didn't have a location for the ride this year. And I went over there into that fellowship hall and walked into the bathroom and was looking where there's showers and nice restroom. And I walked out and I looked at your basketball court / cafeteria section. I thought, wow, yeah, this church is very blessed. I can remember when this church, you couldn't find a seat in here. I remember. It's no fault of yours, church. It's, as they say, a sign of the times. But it's also a sign that we're getting a little lax.
Yeah.
We're getting a little lazy about inviting people to church. Amen. And I thought, wow, you know, what a platform. We're right here. Alfred and I grew up here on the west side of Charleston. That's where my street smarts come from. I am a goody two shoes. I never did any of the drugs and the alcohol. But I'm also a sister that grew up on the west side, and I know to watch my back, if you know what I'm saying. So I got to looking, and the Lord spoke to my heart and said, wow, wouldn't this be a good place for outreach? Wow, a tent revival right smack dab in the middle of Satan's den. Right smack dab in the middle of it. And so I approached my husband, and I thought, I'll approach my husband and say, see what he says. He says it's stupid, I'll leave it alone. But the minute I said it, I seen he went, yeah. And he talked to Road Dog. Y'all know him as Mark. He'll always be Road Dog to me. Well, praise God. The dog. But Brother Road Dog, he was excited. And then we found out that he was brought to the church about doing that tent revival and that outreach and the Bible community reaching out to Charleston. And I heard the church was excited. I said, oh, Jesus, it's better than that. When you got a church that's excited and behind something like this, God's going to move. Amen? So we're going to do one now. It's kind of a revival song, I guess you'd say. We did this song for a long time. And it was one of our most requested songs. I'm sick to death of it. I'm going to be straight with you. We went to a church service once. It was a tent revival. And this was back when we were a live band. They had us do these songs for 3.5 hours. And I was a singer and a bass player. And I noticed as the service progressed, I was getting shorter and shorter, and that bass was getting heavier and heavier. But I think y'all enjoy it. If y'all know any of the songs, sing along with us on Revival Medley.
You got to.
some of us have. And you know, God has completely wiped that away, man. All that bad stuff in your past, with just one drop of blood. Just one drop. Cleanse. Pure. Sanctify. Holy before God. Amen? Just one drop. Gone. But at the same time, church, let what you've been through be a light and a testimony to others. If you survived it, God allowed it. And if He allowed it, it's because you have a purpose in telling somebody else, hey, that life will kill you. Let me tell you what happened to me. Let me tell you about my Jesus and how He delivered me from that life. Let me tell you what God can do. Amen. But it was all about grace. It was all about mercy. And if you had to stand before a judge, before Jesus, you know where you'd be. You know what the verdict would have been. But it was God's grace and mercy. Deliver and clean. Mercy won't do.
Thank you.
Rockefeller, the one we did down at Chief and Julius. Farther along, I think, was it?
Yeah, it was.
Was it farther along?
Yep.
Is that what that is? Y'all about to get quartet style. What do you think? Yes.
I told John.
Somebody get a picture of her in her jeans and flip flops up here.
I told John, I said, don't you dare tell Martha that I'm going to sing today. He said, I won't. And when she said that, I thought, uh-oh. But I just want to let you know, I'm a child of the King. And I love him above everything. He means everything to me. And the older I get, oh, the closer I feel to him. And I want to get closer and closer because, according to nature, I'm not going to be here that much longer. And I'm looking forward to the day when I can go meet Jesus. I love you. You say it's going to be farther along?
We understand.
you get saved, you don't become superhuman. Now, I'm just going to, for those of you who don't know the rules, for those of you who have not accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, let me just clear that up for you right now. I don't want you to have any delusions. When you get saved, you do not become superhuman. You do not have the faith of a prophet. You do not have the perseverance of Job. You're still human. You can still get sick. You can still get discouraged. You can still get beat down and hurt. But here's the difference. You can go through that right now, and you're on your own. I go through it, and I got Jesus. When I've got nobody else, I got Jesus. When I feel like my husband doesn't understand, my kids don't listen, my parents don't get it, and my friends don't care, I've got Jesus. You can't possibly understand until you're on this side. I can remember the day I got saved. I knelt at the altar, and I've heard so many times how you lay your burdens down. You know, you hear the old song, I want to lay my burdens down. I didn't know what that was like till I knelt at the altar, and I accepted Jesus. And when I stood up, I felt like I was floating on air. I never felt lighter in my life. And it's because Jesus, in that moment, purified me. He took everything off of me. All the stuff that was bothering me and weighing me down and pushing me into the dirt, He lifted that right off of me. You'll never know joy. You'll never, listen to me, you will never, ever find what you're looking for. You will never know peace till you know Jesus. And when you know Jesus, you won't want to look back. You will be so thrilled with your new life. You will literally be a new creature in Christ. Amen. We go through battles. We go through storms. We go through hard times, but we have the Lord. We have the Lord to lean upon. We have the Lord to talk to when nobody else listens to us. When Dana says you're nuts, Jesus listens to you. When your wife says, Lord, I can't take no more of that man, Jesus loves you. Ain't God good? I don't know how the world makes it without Him. I don't know. We're going to do one that I wrote. This one was requested. Don't worry, Superman Joe. I ain't forgot you neither. I know. I'm telling you what now. Hold your hand. Does everybody know who Superman Joe is? Hold your hand up, Joe, so they know who you are. Come on now, put that hand up. That's Subaru Joe right there. That's his biker name. And I'm here to tell you, he'll probably pack a punch and whoop me from one end of that parking lot to the other if I don't do Mule Land. So I'm going to do this song, The Storm, and then I'm going to do Subaru Joe's song, Mule Land. But I want y'all to listen to this and just contemplate. We all go through storms, folks. But Jesus is God. Jesus has got this. Amen. Thank you. We got a request. Look, I still got the mule man. Subaru Joe will have my head. Okay. Lord, I don't know. This is like a jack in a box. Somebody just cranked it and just snuck up on me and surprised me.
When I went down in the river to pray, something about that good old way, and the Lord shall wear a robe and crown. Good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brother, let's go down. Let's go down, come on down.
Thank you.
Yeah.